Do you ever wake up in the morning and cry because you know you'll never be as creatively brilliant as Brian Wilson?
Let me tell you something. We're all pros, you know. We've played with everyone. Heard it all. You name them, we've played with them. But you gotta know that you're touched, kid. You're blowing our minds.
If you were to ask me what the most inspiring scene in all of film is for me personally, I'd have to say a scene in Love and Mercy. In this scene, Brian Wilson talks to his bandmates about how the Beatles' recently released album, Rubber Soul, is the greatest album of all time.
It's amazing. I mean, it works like a whole. It's like a whole album. Everything fits together. No fat, like an album of folk songs, but the sounds are really far out. Lots of overdubbing.
He heard what they made and was so inspired that he had to go above and beyond himself.
We can't let them get ahead of us. I can take us further.
Brian obsessed over his next album in the relentless pursuit of excellence. By several metrics, he succeeded, including getting the recognition of the Beatles. Paul McCartney even went as far as to call God Only Knows, which was a song on the album, the greatest song of all time.
But he eventually came out with this God Only Knows. I just think it's a great song, melody, harmonies, words. It's a great song. I love it. You know, it's just one of my, it's my favorite Beach Boys song.
Pet Sounds changed the way that music was thought about and made. However, the Beatles responded with their own masterpiece, known as Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
With Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
From Rubber Soul to Pet Sounds to Sgt. Pepper's, there was an escalation of quality, and Brian had to continue the trend with his next album, known as Smile. Although Brian had intense ambition for his next project, and spent years making it, it was never released. It's okay, Smile, I never lived up to my potential either. Well, at least it wasn't released until much later.
I've been in this town so long, I'm back in the city, I've been taken for lost.
Part 1, Creative Ambition. Welcome to Aesthetic Testimony, where we talk about the greatest works of art of all time. I chose this album because it was the top album. The third best album on Metacritic. Okay, I'm gonna square with you. I thought this was the top album, and I was so deep in research that by the time I looked back and realized I was wrong about it, it was too late. So I'm really sorry to all of the dedicated Aesthetic Testimony fans. In all honesty, I do have some bias towards talking about this album in the first place. I used to have a podcast with the same premise as this show, where my friend and I would talk about the greatest works of art of all time.
We're going over The Very Hungry Caterpillar.
One of the things we talked about was Pet Sounds, and it ended up becoming one of my favorite albums of all time.
Every single sound on the album, in my opinion, is incredible. Like, I don't think there's any other album I've discovered that every single minute detail I adore.
I was struck by how much of my taste was defined by this album. I had never even heard it before, but it was an inspiration for so many artists that I loved.
We're gonna do Sloop John B today. I feel very lucky that we got this song, because this is actually one of my favorite songs of all time, and Pet Sounds is one of my favorite albums of all time.
Come on, the Sloop John B.
My grandfather and me.
God only knows what I'd be without you. Turn it up, it's the Beach Boys.
She said you're just like Mike Love, but you wanna be Brian Wilson. Brian Wilson said you're just like Mike Love, but you'll never be Brian Wilson.
Yeah, I said.
So what you're trying to tell me is you're a massive Weezer fan.
The pursuit of excellence was the driving force for this album that ultimately created the mythology behind it. Brian Wilson received critical acclaim and praise for the making of Pet Sounds. It's only natural that the follow-up would be hotly anticipated. To surpass the beauty of your magnum opus is no small feat. However, for a creatively driven man, there is no greater goal. The excitement that Brian had for Smile is infectious.
Van Dyke and I wanted to make a title that would catch people's ears. So
so that they would want to hear it. So we said Smile, which we thought was a very appropriate title. So people would say, hey, what's this Smile all about? We want to see what Smile's all about.
He got super deep into the details of making this project, and the whole creative process ended up being almost a bit of an art piece in and of itself. As little pieces of performance art, he would do things like put a sandbox or a tent in his house.
When people come over to see it, they would say, what in the heck are you doing? You know, that's very creative.
The whole album was built to be modular. Different components of the album were recorded and spliced in different ways. It was an innovative way of making music. Brian would arrange the music in one way and then rearrange it in another way, and both would stand on their own as beautiful.
Oh, you can't make that change. And then he would make the change and we go, oh man, that is so cool.
During the creation process, Brian came across this funky dude known as Van Dyke Parks. He had a way with words, and Brian wanted him to write the lyrics for the album. By taking a step back from writing lyrics, Brian was able to focus solely on the composition of this album. The lyrics can almost be described as a tone poem, in opposition to the popular lyrics found in Pet Sounds.
I'm waiting for the day when you can love again. Rock, rock, roll, Plymouth rock, roll over.
Compared to the emotionally driven stories that Pet Sounds told, Smile is a lot more opaque and harder to decipher. The album starts in a chilling way. Our Prayer is a somber a cappella composition. The vocal harmonies are absolutely gorgeous. The absence of lyrics or instrumentation creates almost this sense of anticipation that really sets up the album well. The album seamlessly transitions to a cover of the song G by The Crows.
How I love my girl.
However, the song is remixed to include elements from the next song, Heroes and Villains. Between these three songs, there's a lot of harmony, and it puts a lot of momentum into the album. Heroes and Villains carries this energy into an exciting ballad about the Spanish and American War.
Fell in love years ago with an innocent girl from the Spanish and Indian home of the Heroes and Villains.
Brian, you can't say that. Does this look like India to you? Come on. The concept of this vague tone poem of an album is to capture the essence of Americana on a road trip across the United States. You see, the Beatles, and as a result, Britain, were the culture obsession at the time. Brian wanted to take things back to America and made an American-centered story.
Yeah, America.
However, although Brian wanted this album to be American-themed, he did skew quite heavily towards criticizing America, including the tendencies towards Manifest Destiny.
Don't wanna be an American idiot.
Roll Plymouth Rock is heavily centered around this criticism of Manifest Destiny.
Rock, rock, roll, Plymouth Rock, roll over.
It almost seems to be some sort of command to undo what was done at Plymouth Rock. However, what's done is done. History can't be changed. There's a line repeated in the song, which is in Hawaiian.
Mahalo nui, mahalo nui, kini waka pula.
Roughly translated, it comes out to, thank you very much, it is too late. How do we contend with our history? There's so much violence and cruelty. However, it's too late. For all of the sympathy we can muster, the damage is done. The Barnyard is a little strange, I won't lie. There was actually supposed to be a four-part series of songs about the Barnyard. It has a reference to LSD, so it's probably about drug usage, but it's still just plain strange.
Jump in the pig pen, next time I'll take my shoes off. Hit the dirt, do 2.5, next time I'll leave my head on.
There are also a lot of animal noises, which is what I thought pet sounds would have been.
I thought it'd it'd be like actual pet sounds.
Did you actually think
that?
Yeah,
I thought it was going to be weird.
You thought the Beach Boys were going to produce an entire album of just barnyard animals.
Not just, but like I thought they'd be like implemented in weird ways and I'd be like, what's it?
Then we get to an instrumental cover of The Old Master Painter, followed by You Are My Sunshine. This album was supposed to be a very spiritual experience. When you write a new song, you can only control so much of how the audience is going to react to it. By including pre-existing songs, you can essentially capture the spiritual experience that you intended for the album. The album ends with Cabin Essence.
Cabin Essence, timely hello, welcomes the time for a change.
It's an exciting composition with a steady set of ups and downs that make it a thrilling yet somber experience. It's a song about American expansion and the building of the railroad. When the song speeds up, it's made to sound like workers hammering away at the railroad. Part 2, The Fall. Brian worked relentlessly on the album, but trouble started mounting for him and the band as they kept on working on it with no sight and end for years. Brian's mental health was in severe decline due to a toxic combination of drug abuse, family upbringing that wasn't so good, and mental health disorders.
House is bugged. Okay, Phil Spector has the house booked. He's a vine gangster, and he's angry at me. Dad is listening in all the time! Whisper, okay? I know what I'm talking about.
We're not gonna whisper, Brian! Jeez.
Mike Love is widely recognized as the villain of this album's downfall. He found the lyricism to be disagreeable.
Mike Love said to me one day, he said, explain this. Over and over, the crow cries, uncover the cornfield. And it was an American Gothic trip that Brian and I were working on. I said, I don't know what these lyrics are all about. They're unimportant. Throw them away. And so they did.
He was quite critical of Pet Sounds for its lack of mass market appeal. Smile was everything that Mike Love hated about Pet Sounds, plus more. He was especially critical of the lyricism in the album. He famously pled with Brian to stick with the formula, which is an allegation that he has denied and even Brian has come forward to deny since. But the reputation for him has stuck.
There are some accounts that defend Mike, especially the ones commissioned by Mike himself. It is true that he co-wrote some of the band's biggest and best songs. He did help make Brian's artsy experiments accessible to a wide audience. He's credited as the fun and good time spirit of the band, and it was under his stewardship that they became one of the most reliable touring acts around, and where they gained the title America's Band. But to the public at large, he will only ever be a commercial hack, a stifling impediment to Brian's creativity, and a giant gaping asshole.
Regardless of what's true and what isn't, one thing is abundantly clear, and that is that Brian Wilson does not like Mike Love.
No, I don't like Mike Love at all.
Whether he likes it or not, Mike Love will go down in history as the villain who destroyed Smile. With very little to show for their work, the band went ahead and released Smiley Smile.
I'm gonna be round my vegetables, I'm gonna chow down my vegetables.
A lot of the pieces of Smile are there, but simplified to a tragic degree. The songs on the album are kind of unfinished, and some even speculate that Brian intentionally sabotaged them since they could never live up to their potential. Brian proceeded to spend years in recovery.
He refused to shower and hid in his bed for 2 years.
He hired a psychologist named Dr. Eugene Landy to be his full-time caretaker. It initially seemed to help.
Did Dr. Landy save your life?
Absolutely. Yes, he did.
Unfortunately, Dr. Landy became abusive, controlling every part of Brian's life. He charged Brian $100,000 a month and intentionally gave him the wrong medications. Dr. Landy even took control of Brian's creative process.
One called Heaven is a Card. Helpful healing music. You have to just produce something.
The abuse went on for several years. Thankfully, Brian met the woman that he would eventually marry, Melinda Ledbetter. Melinda reported Dr. Landy for his abuses, And through her help, Brian was able to live a healthy life again. The middle of the album has a heavy theme of growing up. Wonderful is a song about a girl who grows up dedicated to God, but ends up rejecting her upbringing due to finding a boy.
All fall down and lost in the mystery, lost it all to a non-believer.
It's both a haunting and beautiful song. As you grow up, you become a different person than you expected. You make sacrifices and can't always be the person you expected or wanted to be. In the story of Wonderful, this girl met a boy and it changed who she was, and she can't go back to who she was before.
He doesn't look a thing like Jesus, but he talks like a gentleman, like you imagine when you were young.
She ends up becoming a different person than who she was when she was a child. Song for the Children serves as the connection tissue for the song before it and the song after.
I wonder if...
Its presence emphasizes both songs' themes of growing up. The next song is Child is the Father of the Man. At first, it seems like a confusing contradiction. It is the man who fathers the child. A child is the father of the man in the sense that the child grows into who the man will be.
A child. No.
This emphasizes the theme of growing up that was also present on Pet Sounds.
I wanted to show how independent I've grown now, but that's not me.
I think it's appropriate that this album defined Brian Wilson's work as he aged. The turmoil that he went through at a young age defined his career crash as well as his subsequent self-recovery. This album is Brian's story. He needed to become a full person before this could be a full album. Surf's Up, in my opinion, is the crowning achievement of this album.
Surf's Up, aboard a tidal wave.
It's a somber exploration of the very thing that this album was interested in diving deeper into. The lyrics are a little difficult to discern, but the sound gives an indication to what the song is about.
To a muted trumpeter's swan.
There's something that almost feels spiritual about this song, and that is appropriate considering that this song is a song dedicated to God. Surf's Up is an ironic title, referencing the fact that the Beach Boys' days of writing about surfing are over. It's about a man at a concert who feels deeply about the music that he's listening to. There's a beauty that he feels deep in his soul. It's that feeling like you start to understand the world more deeply. At the same time, it feels like you're only scratching the surface of this great truth that you're unlocking. I am also, of course, describing the way that this song makes you feel. It's almost a self-fulfilling prophecy. It's a song about having a transcendent experience with art that has created that feeling within me. It's not immediately approachable, so it took a few listens to get there, but if you can listen to it and it hits you, it's really powerful. Vegetables is a little bit of an outlier in terms of the music on this album.
I'm gonna be round my vegetables. I'm gonna chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all. My favorite vegetable.
During the writing process for this album, Brian was quite evangelistic about the benefits of healthy living. It's a bit of an odd topic, but I personally found the song helpful. When I listen to this song, it actually does motivate me to eat healthier.
But something's wrong!
Exactly! How do we know which ones are the healthy foods to eat?
When the song says,
I know that you feel better.
I'm inclined to believe it. Sometimes you just need a reminder to take care of yourself. Have you taken care of yourself today? If you haven't taken care of yourself today, I am going to come to your house and break your legs.
It's for the best.
Eddie, please! Sleep a lot, eat a lot, crush 'em like crazy.
Part 3, The Return. Time moves on. Even what could be considered your greatest failures can be moved on from. There's a time and a place for everything. Sometimes, if you fail, you move on. There's always something in the back of your brain that wonders what could have been. What if things turned out slightly differently? But what if they could turn out differently? You can't take back the past, but sometimes, when the time is right, you can reclaim what is lost. His now wife, Melinda Wilson, created a life for Brian that was safe and supportive.
I think what happened with him in terms of wanting to make music again and taking it serious was the fact that he had a different environment.
Melinda loved Brian and treated him well, and that gave him the foundation he needed to continue his artistic work. Brian became a concert performer. He had a full orchestra band that played with him. He had a full orchestra band that played with him, and once he started playing, he got to see the love that people had for his music. One of the sets he performed was a full rendition of Pet Sounds.
I once had a dream, so I packed up and split for the city.
Man, what I wouldn't give to be there. If you're watching this in 2004 and have tickets to the show, watch your back, because I'm coming for you. I will get those tickets. For a while, Smile was a band topic of conversation around Brian. His band members would ask him about the songs on the album, but he would quickly shut them down. He couldn't go back to that time.
You bring it up and he says, I don't want to talk about it, or no comment, or he'll say it's inappropriate.
It was a symbol of his trauma, failure, and past mental health struggles. One day, though, at a party, a flip switched for Brian. He was given the opportunity to play the piano, and something changed for him. He played Heroes and Villains for the whole party to hear. They all marveled as this once taboo song was played beautifully in front of them. This party performance gave Brian the confidence to play Heroes and Villains at the end of one of his sets. Brian originally gave up on Smile because he didn't believe in it. He became convinced that no one wanted it. That night, though, the reception he got was overwhelmingly positive.
Thank you so much!
Hey, guys. Thanks for all the comments, and a special thanks to everyone for the tips on detonators.
As an artist, there's a constant pull for whatever you're working on to not be created. You can easily convince yourself that the project you're working on is doomed to fail. You're also terrified about what that will say about you if it is bad. When I started writing the script for the first video of this series, I gave up halfway through. If it wasn't for the friends I have who supported me and believed in me, I don't think I ever would have finished it. When you're creating, your mind will give you every opportunity to stop. The influences around Brian the first time he tried to create Smile dragged him down.
In 1967, the reasons why I didn't finish Smile was Mike didn't like it. I thought it was too experimental. I thought that the fire tape was too scary. I thought that people wouldn't understand where my head was at that time. Those were the reasons.
He had a lot of previous success, so he tried to put together something really ambitious. However, that success could only hold back so much negativity, as it was constantly bombarding him during the original making of Smile. Things were different this time, as he had a known audience for his music and a band that loved and supported everything he did. Brian and his band decided to put together a live performance of Smile. There was still a fair bit of work to be done. Most of the music had been created, but it was just a collection of fragments at the time. They could be placed together, but there was nothing to tie them together. As Brian got back into the work, he got overwhelmed by everything that needed done. A huge help to Brian as he worked on the project was Darian Sahanja, a member of his band. Darian loaded all of the fragments onto his computer and helped Brian compile it using computer software.
So then we have that, but then we also have sections like this.
Father of the man.
So then another section, yeah, that's on that same reel is this.
Wow.
Some of the lyrics were lost and unfinished, so Brian got a hold of Van Dyke Parks to continue working on the album. Van Dyke was hesitant to work on this again, as he had seen what it did to Brian last time.
We both feared that the consequences of any further involvement might be as painful as the last one.
However, Brian was ready and able to make the album happen this time. Smile was so close to becoming a reality. The album that had remained a mystery for so long transitioned from being a fantasy for music fans to something that they were going to actually be able to hear. The songs were written, but as they practiced to perform the music, Brian froze up again.
I was scared to smile, yeah. I thought I was going to bring back the bad feelings, yeah.
He was so close to achieving his dream, but as he got closer, all of the terrible things came back to him. However, as he saw the band practice, something unlocked in him, and he started to get really excited about the work that he was doing.
Paul, the third note up there is not loud enough.
It became therapeutic for him to work on this album that once was a block for his career. The night of the performance came, and people were excited to hear this once lost album.
I came here all the way from Colchester, Connecticut to see Smile tonight in London for the world premiere.
Even Paul McCartney was in attendance.
Hey, Mr. Paul. Good to see you, Paul.
Give me a kiss.
All right.
No talks.
Okay.
I'm sorry, man.
It's okay.
I draw a line.
Alright, I want you to enjoy the next
one.
For you.
You're just so good.
Brian's legacy was thoroughly cemented before this performance. People were excited to see this legend return with new music. There's something so chilling about the opening. It was clear that the crowd loved his performance. At the end of the concert, the crowd was cheering so much that Brian couldn't even get a word in as he tried to thank them all for coming that night.
I'd like to take this opportunity. Hello?
The third act of the album covers the four elements. I'm in Great Shape starts off the theme with the earth, referencing agricultural America. Then there's Wind Chimes, which as you can imagine talks about the air.
Hanging down from my window, those are my wind chimes.
The story behind this song was that Brian got a hold of some wind chimes. He really liked his wind chimes. He thought, that's great, I'm gonna write a song about these wind chimes. Then we have Mrs. O'Leary's Cow. There was a story about the Great Chicago Fire of 1871. It was said that a cow belonging to a Catherine O'Leary kicked over a lamp that started the fire. This is the origin for the title of Mrs. O'Leary's Cow, which, as you can imagine, starts off the fire theme. As a song about fire, it's meant to embody chaos. You can really hear that throughout the song, distractingly so even.
Long ago, the four nations lived together in harmony. Then, everything changed when
Mrs. O'Leary's cow attacked. Finally, we get to water with In Blue Hawaii.
Down in blue Hawaii, so far away from blue Hawaii.
It's a really good send-off to the album before the grand finale. What started in Plymouth Rock ends in Hawaii. Then a section of Our Prayer, the first song on the album, plays at the end. Before Good Vibrations!
I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations.
Good Vibrations is a top tier banger. I'm sure you've heard it. I know it's a top tier banger. You know it's a top tier banger. It was released as a single for Smile way back in the 60s when it was originally being written. It really has gotten the recognition it deserves. It's fun, it's cool, it's exciting. Good Vibrations is in a league of its own. So that's the story of Smile. Shortly after it was performed live, it was made into an album. To the best of my ability, I can't make it any clearer how beautiful the album is. Brian Wilson is largely regarded to be one of the best composers of our time. Smile is a lot less approachable than Pet Sounds, which at times was even unapproachable itself. The lyrics are even harder to decipher. They're more oriented around being poetic. As you listen to the album, focus more on how the words feel than what they actually mean. The question still remains, though, does it achieve the level of excellence that Brian was aiming for? Well, he sure thinks it did.
If you want to put it on a scale of 1 to 10, I'd get Pet Sounds a 4 and Smile a 10.
At the end of the day, does anything else really matter? Does it matter what you think or what I think? This battle seems more personal, and we just get to revel in the victory that happened afterward. For my personal taste, Pet Sounds is still the better album. I find the lyrics to better display the emotional reality of the album. However, I still do really enjoy Smile, and one of my favorite things about it is that it takes work to really appreciate it. It's hard to say what would have happened if Smile released in the 60s. If it had had the time to change music, would we be able to instantly recognize its impact now? Would modern listeners be able to recognize its innovations and the way they changed the course of history if everyone and their mothers had imitated its sound? We'll never know. We will never get Smile as it was initially planned in the 60s. If Brian had been in a better mental state and was able to finish the album, it probably would have turned differently to what we got today. Some people credit most of the work that happened in the 2000s to Darian Sahanja. He put a lot of work into getting the album sequenced and ready. In that way, he was able to overcome a major stumbling block for Brian. I don't think that delegitimizes the album we got, though. With any production, things are constantly changed as they're being made. As various people work on a project, their voices will seep into it. However, on Brian Wilson's front, what greater victory could you ask for? He had to conquer his demons to make this happen. He feared there wouldn't be an audience for his creation, but he ended up finding an audience who loved what he did. It received really high praise and an excellent critical reception. It found its way onto the greatest albums of all time. And it deserves all that recognition. Alright. So that's the end of the video. I hope you liked it. I put a lot of work into it. So if you liked it, could you get me a Monster Energy drink? Or I like the Starbucks double shots. My parents would probably be disappointed in me for drinking energy drinks, but I don't care. Love you, Mom. Bye-bye.